Hi, welcome to my studio. I'm Yvonne Reddick, and this is part two of Painting Like the Old Masters. We're going to be adding a second layer today, so let's have a look at what we did last time. We finished the underpainting, and we used a grayscale made with burnt umber and white. And it, I wanted to get you to have a little look because, as you know, it's impossible to complete a refined underpainting in the time of the show. So it was important that I had this ready for you so that you could see it at the end of part one. And the more grisailles you do, the more you realize how important it is to add lots of the details, all of the details actually, that you want in your finished piece. So I had painted in the reflections of the sky into the water with the bright light, and also the stream edge, darkening the far edge of the stream and painting that reflection in to the stream as well, and the trees, branches, and some lovely light coming through the trees too. So that's been drying for about a week, and it's really important that that first layer, first sitting, is very dry so that this, as we build up the painting, it will be archivally sound. And the old masters knew that building up color with pure layers of pure pigment, rather than mixing pigment, different pigments together on their palette, that it really brought a lot of magic to their work. So that's what we're going to be exploring, adding some color today. And we'll start with a transparent glaze again and work wet into wet, adding some opaques and more transparents as well to build up some of that glow. We're going to start with Chinese orange, and I'm going to mix it approximately half and half to make a beautiful glaze with the medium. So the medium it's not as crucial this time as it was in the first sitting, that we had to have less medium. So just making it nice and juicy and more transparent. And then we can use a large brush. That's just a house painting brush. And we'll glaze over the whole entire piece. This adds harmony to the painting, and of course helps it to glow. Sometimes this might make you nervous when you first go to put this onto your painting. Over that, I love the effects that you get with Chinese orange glazed over a burnt umber underpainting. Okay, isn't that lovely? Make sure that it's wet and juicy enough to pick up as we paint wet into wet. And I'm going to use my mop, small goat hair brush, and just blend a little bit away in our brightest white areas. Still want to leave some of that glaze so that we can pick it up with our white paint, but not too much. And there's the initial glow from glazing over the underpainting. And you can see that we already have some colors starting to appear that we haven't mixed, we haven't added. There's some green tones coming out, and we don't want to wipe off too much of that. And it's the burnt umber and the Chinese orange only. So again, we'll be working lights toward darks, and we'll, you're not worried about your brush strokes, but I just saw a big blob of that glaze there. So I'm going to take a nice stiff hog hair brush and start with the brightest areas and work toward the deepest, darkest areas on the piece. So some nice, strong light peeking up over those background trees. and reflected into the stream. And as you come away with your paint and brush from that highlight, the strongest light, you begin to pick up more of the glaze, which is very beautiful. So painting that sky reflected into the stream. And we want some of that light peeking through the trees and branches. It's quite beautiful. Now you need to know that you can come back and punch up some of those nice bright whites later on as the glaze settles down. It's a good time to do that. Now coming up into the glaze on the sky with the white, but allowing not much on my brush and allowing the brush to pick up more of the glaze. So you can see not too much paint on the brush. And then again with the goat hair mop, I can start to form the sky. Now, knowing that this is the second sitting, but we're going to do a part three where we build up even more color. So this today won't be the end result of all the color that we want to add into this lovely landscape. A little bit more of the white, and then blending. Okay, so we'll also get, with a different brush, get some of the white into the sky holes, but make sure we pick up enough glaze on the brush. Just get some of those established, but we're going to lose most of those in about a minute. So we'll not worry about them too much right now. We'll go back in and reestablish some sky holes in a bit. So now we're going to use some transparent red iron oxide. And I've mixed that white that I was using, I had pre-mixed that with just a couple of drops of the medium, of the oil painting medium, to make it nice and juicy to work with. And I've mixed transparent red iron oxide with approximately a third medium to two-thirds pigment, and that makes a nice, beautiful texture, and the medium helps the paints to dry well as well. So now we're going to use a palette knife and bring some of this red iron oxide back into those background trees. And last week we talked about, in part one, we talked about leaving some texture in the trees to be able to catch this time. And you'll see that the palette knife, the paint, as I'm loading mostly the edge of that knife, and then the texture is catching the paint and making some lovely effects. Good. Now I'll just work on this side rather than work the whole piece so that I can demo for you in this short time to give you a pretty good idea of where you would go with the whole piece. And since, again, it takes longer than our show to complete this sitting, I do have one ready for you to see the completed version. Okay, so again, I'm continuing to catch texture with the knife. And I would be going all across here as well. Now I'm going to put down the knife and use a brush for some more of that transparent red iron oxide. Isn't it a gorgeous color? I love it. The transparent oxides are all quite earthy, and I use this one quite a bit. So now I'm taking some of that paint and, whoops, that's the wrong color. Don't want to get into the dark color yet. Don't want that on the brush. So I'll clean that off with a bit of the medium. That's a good thing to know how to do, is use a bit of medium if you need to take some pigment out of your brush while you're painting, so that you don't introduce anything else into the paints, just the medium that you're using anyway. And some of that transparent red iron oxide, I'm loading my brush and then holding it parallel to the canvas to pick up the texture again, rather than just painting solid. It adds to the nice loose painterly look of those trees. Okay, and trying to avoid the sky holes, but knowing that we can come back in and reestablish them in a bit. So these techniques are what people like Rembrandt and Titian and Caravaggio and so many others, they studied, they researched, they experimented, and we're just so lucky that we have people that have researched to be able to pass down all the magic of their knowledge and their techniques they used. Okay. Now I want some of that color in the foreground in the meadow. So the foreground will be nice and warm and also a nice deep color. So again, I'm trying to hold the brush parallel to the support, to the canvas or board that you're painting on, allowing the texture to pick up the paint. And as you can see, you start to get already, start to get the look of a meadow, a grassy meadow with lovely texture and not overworked. And I want to keep that in the foreground so that as the meadow goes away from the viewer, it becomes not as deep and dark. But I want some of that also along the edges of the stream, some of that transparent red iron oxide. So now, I tend to use one arm as a mall stick sometimes to steady my arm. If you're at all like me and you tend to shake a little bit, don't let anyone tell you you can't paint because you shake. It totally works. Sometimes it's a good thing. Okay, so now the reflection of some of that foliage we're going to bring down into the stream. And I'm just very captivated these days with reflections in streams and rivers and water. Okay, so let's see, as I was saying, normally I would be doing each color on the whole piece, but just wanting to give you a really good idea of demoing one section. Okay, it's getting lighter as we go back. And you can see that we already have so many beautiful shades, even though we haven't added a lot of color yet. And the grisaille was nice because it established the tonal values, and that's a beautiful thing, is that it allows you to concentrate on establishing tonal values. Now, you always have to step back a little bit to see your progress and how it's looking. A little bit more over here, I'm thinking. There we go. I'm going to take a rag and just take a bit of that orange glaze off of at the very back of the meadow where it doesn't, you don't want it as warm, and you want a bit of light at the very back to help push it back. Not too much. Sometimes if I have gloves on, I'll just use my finger because my finger doesn't remove as much of the glaze. Oh, that's kind of nice. Okay, and that blending brush, we can just make sure that we, oh, the only thing is you don't want to lose too much of your texture. You want to keep that nice meadow look. Okay, we'll go back in. There we go. Now, the next color will be the darkest color we'll use today, and it's burnt umber again. But it's burnt umber with no white mixed in, just some medium mixed in with it. And about a third medium to two-thirds pigment again. And I'm going to clean that small palette knife. You can see that I'm using the small palette knife for applying paint. I find one about that size is lovely. So I'm loading the edge and going to go back in and strengthen the trunks and the branches, and again picking up texture. And that burnt umber has enough medium to make it nice and juicy. And now we'll start to get some nice contrast with deeper, darker trunks to those trees and some more branches, which is really important to the piece. Isn't that lovely? And holding it parallel, I should be able to pick up some of that texture that was there last week and make that look just so lovely and painterly and effective too, I think. So we have some little tree branch guys in there. Now, knowing that in our third sitting, we're going to be adding more color. So this is establishing more contrast and starting to build up the color. Okay, really important to have enough contrast this sitting. Good. A little bit more over here. And I'm going to wipe that knife and go back to the transparent red iron oxide. A few more of the branches. That, now there's quite a bit there, but all you have to do is take your knife and then your brush and spread that around a bit. We do want some more color in the upper parts of those trees. And now I'm loading the whole flat end of the knife, the whole side, rather than just the edge, to try to get a bit more color up in those branches. And now the brush that I was using for the transparent red iron oxide. And wipe a bit of that away. There we go. And if any of the branch areas, you want to break some of them up so that there's foliage cutting through them, just go in with your brush. Now remember, this brush will be now picking up some of that raw umber. Burnt umber. It's not raw, sorry. It's burnt, it's warmer. The raw umber would be a cooler tone. You can always remember that the burnt umber is like burnt toast, it's warm. Okay, so then we're wanting to reestablish some of those sky holes. So we'll go in, which brush was a good one for that? This one's good, where we're going back in. And you'll need to wipe your brush quite often for this, as you pick up some of those darker colors. And the sky holes really add so much to the piece. Tricky though, that's really important to have contrast in the sizes and shapes. So you have the palette knife work we did last week should add to the randomness. So you're picking up some of those, really important to not have those sky holes be too large or too uniform. So I'm going to take a bit of that transparent orange, it's called Chinese orange, and mix it with a little bit of the white to get a tone or a couple of shades that will look like the shades in the sky. And inside the tree, it might be a little bit, the light is getting in a little bit darker, so you don't want it too bright. And remembering that next week, we'll be working in there again too, so there we go. Good, okay. And making sure you have enough to add to the, it's just lovely having light peek through, isn't it? There we go. And now down here, they'll be stronger. So less of the Chinese orange. In fact, I'm going to go in with pretty much pure white to create some of those. And in keeping with where the strongest light is. And down into the reflections. So we'll need to use the knife again, clean off that lighter mix and do some of our burnt umber to reflect those branches and tree trunks, and hopefully catching some of that texture again from last sitting. Lovely. And if you're having trouble with the knife, you can use the edge of a brush here. Now you can see that my branches have gone down into the meadow. I don't want them in the meadow. So I'll clean off with a dry brush. There we go. There we go. And bringing some of that white. Now let's just finish some of that foliage of the trees. How do you say that word? Okay, and let's just soften some of the, make sure that brush is clean, soften some of the edges of the tree branches, where the light peeks through. You might need a little bit more of the sky color on your blending brush, on your mop. Good. So there, isn't that lovely? And now we'll, at the end, you would make sure that you punch up the white in the area where you want it to be brightest. And once that's all finished, then we'll be able to, it's best if you stand back and see, okay, do I have enough darks and enough of my brightest lights, and do check your contrast and so on, and of course composition. So the finished second sitting will look like this. There we are. So that is, has some lovely branches and so on, and the reflections in this into the stream, which I think are a really important part of this piece. And it's exciting because these are gorgeous colors to then layer again in part three, in our third sitting, and we'll be able to start using some greens and some yellows and build up layers of pure pigment, which really do create some magic. And I think I feel like the piece is already starting to glow, and that's really exciting. So I hope that you have had fun watching, and it's been really nice to spend a little bit of time with you. And hopefully some of you will try it out and do some of this as well. And I look forward to part three and adding some more color.